Noina in the film is 70, and Lucy is only turning 43 this year. The film also demonstrates that older and sicker elephants can be safely moved to sanctuary. And of course, ultimately, that's what we would like to see for Lucy. But we're certainly not pushing for her just to be thrown on a truck and take a chance. We've asked that they allow independent species experts to come and examine Lucy and weigh in on what their opinion is as to how she would fare traveling a long journey to sanctuary. Also want to point out, as you saw in the film, it was difficult transport. It was difficult getting Noina up on that truck, and it was fairly traumatic for her. If Lucy was to move, it would be quite a different situation, and it would be similar to how they moved the Toronto elephants. Also mention that now that Toronto, Calgary, and Vancouver have moved their elephants south, Lucy is the only remaining elephant left in a Canadian city zoo. So the Toronto elephants were moved with a huge group of experienced elephant handlers and vets. They brought up the transport crate weeks and months in advance of their move so that they could slowly adapt and get used to going in and out of the trailer. That wasn't the luxury that Lek had with this transport. The elephant also had bad experience with being transported, which made her skittish to get into the trailer. With Lucy, we would anticipate it would go much more smoothly. The transport team and the sanctuary would make a contingency plan for Lucy along the way, so that if she needed to be offloaded for care, if she's stressed, they would make arrangements at various spots along the journey that she could, you know, come off the trailer if need be for veterinary care or whatnot. But again, we're simply just wanting to hear from unbiased experts. So far, only zoo vets have weighed in on whether Lucy could survive, and we're simply asking to allow outside veterinarians in. The costs for that have already been covered, so it wouldn't cost the city or the zoo or the taxpayer anything to have this team of world-renowned experts weigh in on Lucy. Should they decide that Lucy wouldn't be able to be safely moved to sanctuary, we certainly don't want anything to happen to her, so we would just advocate at that point for her to have better living conditions. You saw the elephants wallowing in mud and loving to swim. Lucy doesn't have that opportunity. Not only does she not have companionship, but she doesn't even have a place to swim. Swimming is vital for Asian elephants, and it's very important for their well-being, but extra important for an elephant like Lucy. At Elephant Nature Park, when they get a new elephant in, they have to segregate that elephant for a period of time. They will build a pool specific for that elephant in a matter of weeks. 41 years later, Lucy still has no pool. If she did have one, it would be therapeutic because she suffers from arthritis and foot disease. It would give her a chance to be in the water and let the buoyancy of water take pressure off of her joints. It would also allow her to get some exercise, you know, on those cold winter months where studies have been done that show that Lucy spends up to 75% of her time indoors, and her indoor enclosure is only half an acre. I mean, is only 2,200 square feet. So she's certainly not getting the exercise she should, and a pool would facilitate that for her. So that's one of the things we push for. But more importantly, we would have rather see her at sanctuary, because even with the pool here in Edmonton, we still have our climate issues, and we still have the fact that she would remain an elephant alone. And according to any expert, keeping an elephant alone is cruel. You'll also notice in the film the bull hooks. Lucy's still being managed with bull hooks at the Valley Zoo. Many progressive zoos now have gone away from using bull hooks and use positive reinforcement. We don't believe the zoo is beating Lucy, but at some point, as was mentioned in the movie, she did undergo a beating, like the crush box, that made her docile enough to be willing to make paintings at the Valley Zoo, to do the tricks that they get her to do when they bring her out for the Lucy talk. They get her to do tricks. All of those things she wouldn't do had she not undergone something similar. So by seeing the bull hooks, Lucy remembers very well what those do, and she's compliant through fear. And we would rather see her being, you know, trained with positive reinforcement. So just before we start the Q&A, we have just a short clip of video clip of Lucy that I shot at the Edmonton Valley Zoo during one of her wintry walks. Hopefully our projectionist is able to cue that up. Maybe not. Anyways, we'll see if that video comes up, but when and if it does, what I would like you to notice is the difference in the speed in which Lucy moves. You saw when Noina was upset and how she was running. Noina could run circles around Lucy. Lucy is a very slow-moving elephant. She moves like an elephant that's twice her age. You can see her keepers next to her are holding bull hooks, and that's to control her movements while she's walking through the zoo. I noticed that they don't want Lucy going towards the trees or damaging any of the foliage in the Valley Zoo, so her walks are very, very controlled. With each step, you can see that it's painful for her. She does have foot disease and arthritis, so if you can imagine walking in bare feet on hard-packed snow and ice, it must be excruciating for the cell. And then finally, one last picture before we start our Q&A with Ashley Bell. And it's just a picture of myself with Lek Chilert at Elephant Nature Park. Lek has been a very vocal spokesperson to speak out on Lucy's behalf. She's actually gotten into tears when we've discussed Lucy. She's very concerned, number one, about the climate. In Thailand, when they get their cooler weather, and cooler weather in Thailand, we're talking 14 to 16 degrees Celsius, that's on the plus side, they will put coats on their elephants, they'll build fires near their bedtime enclosures. Lek has seen elephants go down from cold stress, and sometimes they don't get back up again, so she's very concerned about that. She's also concerned about the fact that Lucy's alone, and she has made the offer to come to Edmonton to actually speak with our city officials, to be able to, you know, explain to them how successfully she's been able to rescue actual older elephants. And unfortunately, because our city officials have been uninterested in hearing from outside parties, we all know what happened to Bob Barker, or we may not know, but when Bob Barker came to Edmonton, he was basically shunned and berated and told to mind his own business. So I've been reluctant to take Lek up on her offer. She's a busy woman doing amazing work, to have her come to Edmonton and have the doors shut on her. We did invite the zoo to be part of this talk about Lucy. We're present at all of the 5 film screenings. We wanted to do a panel discussion so that we could have an open conversation about Lucy, who's examined her, what their stand is, and why they won't consider letting outside vets in. But unfortunately, when the Metro invited them, they declined to come. We also put out an invitation to all of City Council. So I will conclude that. Just a reminder, if you haven't filled out a postcard for Lucy yet, we are sending those off to City Hall, hoping that they will at least put her on the agenda so we can have a discussion about her future. If you'd like to join her local advocacy group, LEAP, Lucy's Edmonton Advocates Project, there are cards on the table out in the lobby. So I'll conclude with that, and we'll get on with our Q&A. Hopefully you guys have some questions lined up for Ashley. And there she is.
Hi, all. Hello.
Hi, Ashley.
Hey, good morning.
So please welcome the director and producer of Love and Bananas, Ashley Bell. Ashley was born and raised... Sorry, I'm just going to do a little intro, Ashley. Ashley was born and raised in Los Angeles. She made her feature film debut in The Last Exorcist 1 and 2. Ashley has also appeared in television shows such as CSI, The Walking Dead, Boston Public, and many more. She is also an ambassador for Cruelty Free International. And now Ashley has made her directorial debut in her fascinating documentary, Love and Bananas. So again, give a warm welcome to Ashley. Good afternoon, Ashley, and thank you for joining us here in Edmonton today. The audience has just finished watching your incredible film, Love and Bananas. This is the second screening in Edmonton, and the response to your film has been really positive. I could tell viewers were on the edge of their seats, as was I watching the film. So we'll start off. If anyone has any questions, you can either come up to the microphone, or we have someone that will bring a portable mic to you if you have questions. So just please raise your hand, and we'll address your questions as they come.
Thank you all for coming. This is the first screening of Bananas Canada, which is very exciting for us. And thank you for spending your Saturday with Asian Elephants.
And thank you for spending your time with us from your busy schedule. So was there anyone that did have a question?
It's Sunday. I have the memory of an elephant. Happy Sunday.
Looks like we've got one here.
Hi, my name is Caitlin. And I just wanted to say thank you so much for your work. Sorry, I'm emotional.
It's okay.
I've been able to volunteer with Elephant Nature Park twice now, and I just want to say thank you so much for shedding the light on something that is so important. And the movie was absolutely beautiful, and I can't wait to share it on social media and try to bring more awareness to it. But I was just wondering a little bit more about your experience, how that felt for you going through something that traumatic, but so coming out of it, just such a beautiful experience. I just wanted to know a little bit more about how you felt through that.
Oh, well, first of all, so much volunteering at Elephant Nature Park. One of the most extraordinary parts of bringing this film out into the world has been to meet in person and virtually people that have volunteered with LAC. And there's such an honesty in her sanctuaries and such a precedent that she sets of hope and constant giving and constant forward activity that it was so important for us in the film to get that spirit right for all of our sake that has spent time with LAC and at Elephant Nature Park. So really, thank you so much for coming and for coming to the theater today. I don't think it dawned upon me the situation I was in until I was in the back of that truck with Noina, on the 23-hour journey across Thailand. It had been something I'd wanted to experience for 2.5 years, but the reality didn't actually sink in until I was there. And I remember so carefully putting my hand on the beam that divided Lek and I from Noina, and Lek just very gently moved my hand to the other side of the wooden beam. And she said, no, in case she crushes your hand. And I was like, okay, well, that's about where we're at. The experience as a whole has been remarkable to have been allowed in Lek's shadow and to tell her story in this way. It was in the times that it was scary. That is the reality that Lek has to go through every day to do the work she's doing on the front lines to save Asian elephants. Her life has been in danger multiple times, but she has an indomitable spirit that overcomes all, and her determination to save the species outweighs, it seems, any fear she has. So it was a real honor to tell the story.
Thank you so much for all of your work and all of your work you've done. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just have a quick question. How did you first learn about Lek and her work with elephants?
Yeah, I first learned about Lek through an LA-based attorney called David Castleman. He's one of the executive producers of Love and Bananas and the founder of the Cambodia Wildlife Sanctuary. And also, David has been doing pro bono work for years to work to get Billy out of the zoo in Los Angeles. And from what I've heard of your introduction briefly, Billy and Lucy seem to be having across the board, all the same exact medical conditions and injuries. But I've known about Lek as just this rock star of environmental conservation, and I actually was pretty tongue-tied to meet her the first time. But originally, as I mentioned briefly at the beginning of the film, Love and Bananas was going to be a short, happily ever after story. And when I saw what was happening in Cambodia in person, it was very naive to think it was going to be a happily ever after story. It was a grim scene, but again, going back to kind of the work Lek does, her fight and her spirit to help the elephants was what compelled me to want to tell Lek's story.
Oh, we've got another question in the audience. Just one moment. Oh, there's one here and then one over there after.
So are there any other causes that you're interested in? I mean, clearly this is one, but is there anything else that you're like, maybe that's also a story to tell?
Any other causes I'm interested in? Gosh, I mean, sure, of course. I feel, you know, all of our animals currently in our ecosystems are under attack and in threat, especially with the new administration in the States. I was born and raised a vegetarian, so I've always been aware of the plight of animals. I've always believed in using cruelty-free products, both for the safety and the condition of your own personal living space and your conscience, and to help these animals with the horrendous conditions that they're in. I visit a lot of sanctuaries and a lot of organizations, but as of right now, elephants are my main focus. But hopefully that'll shift very soon. Recently, I did a birthday tradition that my dad introduced me to when I was about 8 years old. Every year on my birthday, I go rescue a crab and set him free in the ocean. So that happened last month, but other than that, it's mainly elephants.
Okay, thank you. And I think we have one more. Yeah, here we go.
Have you thought about making a version of your film and put it on like more wider media, like YouTube and stuff like that? Because your film deserves a much wider audience. Like if you put it in a cinema, very few people can come to and see it. But if you put it in a really public media, like YouTube or some of the other media, then a lot more people can see it, and you can direct people to your personal website or whatever, and they can get a better understanding, and maybe more people will get to know the problem that these elephants are facing, and then maybe you can have more support.
Absolutely. That's a great question. Yes, Bananas will broadcast a view on Stars on July 30th. And I'm going to be able to share some digital news about where we're going to be releasing digitally very, very soon. But absolutely, this is just the first wave of our release, and we're going to be releasing Love and Bananas. We're going to continue to be releasing Love and Bananas on wider platforms as the year goes on.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I just have two little questions. One is, I'm wondering where Lek gets her funding, if some of it's government, and or what proportion is government and what is not. And the other question I had, when she was able to turn that man around from the trekking camp to having his own sanctuary that actually did better than the trekking camp ever did, I wondered if Lek's own family we're aware of his transition and whether there's any change in attitude from her family.
Absolutely. Well, so awesome fact, since we love and bananas, Leck has been able to turn 37 trekking camps into humane sanctuaries. So, incredible response. I'm not yet sure about Lex's family, but it's been overwhelming, the support she has gotten from certain camps looking for humane options. At Elephant Nature Park in Chiang Mai, it is the number one tourist destination because it starts with the demand. It's really supply and demand. So if people are asking for more humane sanctuaries and just to be with elephants as elephants, more humane sanctuaries will be offered. So hopefully it looks like the tide is beginning to turn in that way, and just keep on demanding it. In regards to where Leck gets her funding, it's mainly through volunteer work. Leck offers a volunteer program at Elephant Nature Park and her other satellite sanctuaries. She has sanctuaries in Cambodia, in southern Thailand, in Surin. In addition to all the trekking camps that have turned into humane sanctuaries like Elephant Nature Park, people can go and volunteer at those sanctuaries and to work for the elephant, as Leck says. And there's a day program, there's an overnight program, you can stay for a week, 2 weeks, and volunteer with Leck.
I want to ask about why they didn't tranquilize Noyna. It will be easier to transfer her or put some kind of tent over her. And another question about tusks. Like, looks like tusks were removed from most of the animals, elephants, and how they're doing without them in nature.
So in regards to tranquilizing Noyna, that is actually a complicated procedure than it sounds. For instance, elephants sleep only 4 hours a night. And when they are they sleep actually on a hill so that they can be able to get upright, because if they sleep completely sideways, the weight of their ribcage will break their ribcage. So when they're tranquilized, especially for that long, you have to make sure that they're not going to die by whatever position they're abnormally put in, because it will be a position they don't get into naturally, and for them not to crush themselves. In regards to putting a tent over the truck, I asked Leck about that, and she said that wouldn't do anything because the heat stroke that we were experiencing was 360 degrees. It wasn't necessarily, it gets so hot and so humid and the air gets so just suffocating that a scrim or a curtain wouldn't have made the difference for Noyna in those conditions. Also, people have asked why there wasn't IVs happening on the truck. That's because Noyna was in such a state. She was so upset and so fragile that if, you know, we had a vet tech with us the entire time, they feared that if they went to go inject her with the needle, she would panic and tip the truck. What was the other question?
It was about the tusks.
The tusks. So the tusks are, so for female elephants, they have tushes, which are tiny, tiny tusks. So Noyna was a female elephant, so she had the smaller tusks. In addition, Leck has said that a lot of time with elephants in Southeast Asia, because the big great tuskers have been killed for so long, they're not, that gene isn't being bred anymore. So elephants are being bred with smaller and smaller tusks, so you're not getting that big, grand, tusker-like elephant that we're accustomed to see in old photos or in children's books. It's very, very sad. And yes, sometimes tusks are removed. Lek has encountered many elephants that when she gets to them, their tusks will be removed in the jungle. They'll either be sawed off or removed from the base, and Lek has a whole treatment plan to help them with that. And oftentimes because of that, their whole body will become infected and almost going septic. And Lek has a whole plan to help many elephants that have had their tusks removed by abuse in a completely horrific way. And she's actually has a lot of those elephants at Elephant Nature Park and has brought them back to health.
Hi, I have a question from one of our viewers online here, and she wonders that if you could talk directly to the Edmonton City Council right now, what would be your message?
My message to the Edmonton City Council would be what my message is to the City Council for Billy at the Los Angeles Zoo. One of the most remarkable things about bringing Love and Bananas into the world is that kids want to see elephants be elephants. A lot of the times people hold elephants at zoos because they think it's going to be an audience attraction or because they think kids want to be able to see elephants in this way. I've had kids ask me, or in regards to seeing elephants alone at a zoo, where's that elephant's friends? These are herd animals. These are animals that, due to their body structure, need to walk miles a day. They have soft padded feet to cover miles and miles of ground. They need the mental stimulation of finding food and water as they forage for these miles. And they're herd animals. They're neurologically proven to exist in a herd. They need a herd for survival and for social stimulation. That is a part of their mentality, and they will go back to that mentality if taken out of it. So my argument is, it's 2018. Let's change the way we think about things. Let's update these archaic methods, and let's let these elephants be elephants. I'm also going live on my Instagram, and I talked about and will also post and tweet about Leap and Lucy. I was unaware of Lucy's plight, but if there's anything that we can rally with the Love and Bananas social media community, we will, to get involved and sign whatever petitions or do whatever we can do in the States to help you guys out.
We so appreciate that. Thank you. Is there anyone else that has any questions? Looks like we got one more.
Hi, I also volunteered for a week 2 years ago. It's life-changing. One little plug I'd like to say would be, it's not just for young people. I was worried I'd be the oldest one there, and I wasn't. So
yeah.
There's families that go. There's one lady I met, she was about 75, and she had gone every year for years. And also let people know that, I know you focus mostly on the elephants, but they also have the dog sanctuary, and they've rescued over 400 dogs and cats as well. So we went walking the dogs, and it was just something else to do. But one thing I'm really happy about is the bull elephants, that there's going to be a sanctuary for them, because I guess they're so aggressive that they don't keep them at the Elephant Nature Park. So it'd be interesting for you to maybe go back and do a documentary about the bull elephant sanctuary to see, you know, how they're, because they're just so aggressive when they're musking. Because I don't think there was really many male elephants at the Elephant Nature Park. So it'd be something to look, that would be a good documentary.
That's awesome. Yes, Castleman and the Woman Life Sanctuary is working on. And like mentioned in the credit report, they have broken ground first sanctuary happening in Cambodia. And it's going to be incredible and extraordinary. They, you know, as you mentioned, bull elephants go through a period of musk, which is when it looks as if they're sweating from their temples, but it's not. They're secreting a gland, and they pretty much just go charging through the jungle, knocking over trees when they're left in, on their own. It's this period for them, nobody has really created a bull sanctuary that allows them the space, truly the space, to be able to do that in a completely safe way. So Cambodia is looking to do that. They have thousands and thousands of acres that they're currently working to try to fence so that each bull elephant will have their own enclosure to start with. And then when it looks like they can, cohabitat and be together, they will then let them acclimate and be together. The elephants that you see in the movie that are out and about are female elephants, except for the young babies. What's happening with male elephants and really finding a place for really the space for them to do their thing and live humanely is so necessary. Another thing, Billy at the LA Zoo, is Billy is a male elephant that is constantly in a state of musk, which is not supposed to happen, but because he doesn't have the environment to move and live and be an elephant in, he's in a year-long continuous state of musk. It's definitely another problem that needs to be addressed, especially with elephants in captivity or sanctuary. And yes, Elephant Nature Park, you can, we're getting ready to do kind of our iTunes release of the film, date TBD, but I'll be announcing it very shortly. But in it, we have what it's like to volunteer at Elephant Nature Park. And yes, it's totally safe for teenagers, but you will meet people of all ages from all around the world, people that have a common interest, a shared goal in mind. It's a wonderful experience. You help with dogs, you help with rescue cats. Lek has rescued bulls, water buffalo, pigs. She's rescued a couple horses, owls, kittens, ducks. You name it, when you get there, you'll be in for a treat of truly a Noah's Ark experience of animals that Lek has rescued for Elephant Nature Park.
Anyone else?
I don't have a question, but I'd just like to point out that from the people that I've talked to today, there's probably at least seven of us that have been at Elephant Nature Park volunteering.
That's amazing. I will Facebook message that Lek.
Lex certainly getting her name out there and getting the recognition she really deserves. There's another question here.
Just the observation of watching Lex transform that man who was doing the tracking program, it's such an example of how we need to transform people without anger. She did that with love. It was one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. And just we're in such a divisive kind of culture where when someone disagrees with us, we get angry. Instead of get gentle, we get loving. And just that scene with him putting the mud on your face, it's just really just one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Really, thank you. When she's come out and partaken in Q&As, she said, so often with animal rights people, they love animals, but they hate humans. And she said, we can't afford to do that. What's really the key to saving the species is education. You know, for Mr. Chai Hong, it was tremendously scary, and it was a big big risk he took to turn his camp into a humane sanctuary. He has one of the biggest trekking camps and circuses in Kanchanaburi. And he's surrounded by trekking camps. And as we mentioned in the film, it's been a practice that has happened for generation after generation. So for him to, you know, like explain to me, she said it's not, there isn't the entrepreneurial spirit. You can't just wake up one day and say, oh, I think I'm gonna completely change the way my whole family has ever done things. No. There's not the support that will rush in to help you when you make that change. So he was very, very hesitant to do it. And Lek has a team that when he did decide to make that change, she brings a whole team in to help support him as that transition process happens. Mr. Shyapar actually came to the United States for the first time in San Francisco 2 weekends ago. We were up in San Francisco, we played to sold-out houses. When Lek and Mr. Taipong came onto the stage, they were just greeted with a huge standing ovation, which Lek wanted to show this to Mr. Taipong, to show him how much of an impact he made and how much of a hero he is, because unfortunately, he has, I think, 7 children, and half of his family is not talking to him because of the decision he made. Half of his kids completely support this decision, and what we were unaware of was the other half of his family do not support it. So Mr. Taipan came 2 weekends ago, and his family, and they were just greeted with just love and support and standing ovations and praise and questions, because what he did was truly heroic. And, you know, as I mentioned, since the filming happened, 37 other camps have changed. So huge, huge thanks to him. He was a trailblazer, and I'm excited to hear again from Lek soon to hear how many more camps will turn.
I was just wondering what you think the future is for elephants, considering that they're losing the habitat. Sounds like there's, you know, the sanctuaries are changing, the trekking camps are changing, but is there any future for elephants? Because they're losing in Africa, they're losing land, in Asia, they're losing land in India, like, and I know we need elephants, but what is the future for elephants?
Yeah. In preparation, I was researching online and I saw something that said Asian elephants will be extinct by 2020. And I was like, oh my God, what is this fact? I have to vet it. And I brought it to a bunch of different conservationists and Lek. And I said, is this true? Will Asian elephants be extinct in 2020? And across the board, these conservationists said to me, there are people every day working on the front lines to save this species. It would completely deflate the work they're doing and the perseverance they have to even advertise that this species will go extinct. They're risking their lives and they're fighting for awareness in the States and to protect them against threats happening across Southeast Asia. So, no. This species will not go extinct, not on our watch. And that's across the board what I'm saying. And it gave me chills and grit, and I believe that.
I have one more question from someone online. It says, I completely agree that it's all about education, but what do you do when people refuse to meet with you to discuss it, such as the Edmonton Valley Zoo and the City of Edmonton?
Well, I don't it's like water will go to rock. You know, it takes patience and it takes time. The patients that Lek employs on a daily basis and a yearly basis and a decade-long basis baffles me how she can find that amount of patience within her. I think it's proving that audience's needs are turning. It's by showing them the facts. It's by showing them that people don't want to see, people are upgrading their thinking. People don't want to see elephants suffering or elephants in zoos or circuses. People want to experience elephants as elephants or elephants living in at least more humane sanctuaries. I would say a lot of it, you know, a lot of what we've been doing in terms of the research here, a lot of major, major change comes from mobilizing the youth. Going into classrooms, having kids sign letters, having kids write petitions. They're gonna listen to kids. And I think it's by, you know, look, if the zoo isn't gonna change it, we can take it upon ourselves to go into classrooms and to change it from the ground up. And when those kids are inspired and they don't want to see elephants like that, they're asking, why is that elephant being beaten? Why is it alone? Why did that man keep his elephants that way? These are the kind of questions we're getting from like fourth graders, third graders. When kids are demanding a change, that's the future. And that's what we're using in the United States to help with the rollout of this film, which has been successful, and to help free Billy at the LA Zoo. And I think that could potentially be a key. Other than that, I encourage them. I encourage anybody to watch Lek's footage, the footage that Lek gave us of the crush box. That was her footage that she entrusted myself and the documentary production company Change for Balance with, who made Love and Bananas. She entrusted us with that footage. I would dare anybody to watch that crush box footage and to say, oh great, yeah, I'll let that continue to happen on my watch.
Just like to thank you so much, Ashley, for being part of this and helping us shine a light as well about Lucy during the screenings of your fantastic film. We've got three more showings here in Edmonton, and we're going to continue to try to spread the word that Lek does, and we're going to work hard for Lucy. We also advocate for Billy when we can. Advocates across the globe sort of share information and work collaboratively. And we certainly hope that Billy and Lucy one day will have an opportunity like Noina did to live out their remaining years in the sanctuary. We thank you so much for taking time from your busy schedule. Everyone, as you're leaving, we are taking a collection for Lek Chillard and her Save Elephant Foundation. The funds will be delivered directly to Lek to help her continue rescuing the elephants that she rescues from the tourist industry. So thank you all for coming. Thank you, Ashley. It's been a pleasure.
I wanted to thank you so much. A lot of times people at least ask how to get involved through Love and Bananas. If I may share, a huge part of doing this film was launching an impact campaign along with the film. So if you feel inclined to, I mean, it sounds like a lot of people are very involved, deeply involved with Asian elephants and have volunteered with Lek. But if being a part of the Asian elephant community is new to you or you want to take some action items, you can go to loveandbananas.com. We have an impact page and four steps that you can take. As I mentioned, the first one, the key to saving the species is education. We have shareable resources that you can tweet and post and share and download and get out there. The second one is we actually have a humane travel pledge that says you won't support exotic animals being used for entertainment. The third is we've partnered with The Greater Good, who's actually launched the Love and Bananas Fund, inspired by the film. The original goal was to raise $40,000 to free an elephant named Civili in Laos and a bunch of medical equipment that Lek needed. We actually ended up raising $80,000, with 100% of those proceeds going to Lek on the ground. And the fourth is we actually offer community screenings and home screenings. So until the movie is available on Stars, if you would like to take Love and Bananas and share it at your school or college or library, organization, community center, you can reach out to our impact producer on loveandbananas.com and we can arrange to get Love and Bananas to your organization. So there you have it.
That's incredible. Thank you again. Thank you all for coming. Please feel free to stop by our table if you have questions about Lucy.
Thank you again.